Right, so recording is on now. I heard that you have some inter-school competition going on. Is it correct? Is there such event? Satyam, there was in NPS HSR. Okay. Anyways. So, all right, so now we should start. The others will join a little late and will miss something. So, in the last session, we started this chapter waves. Okay. And in the last session, we talked about the kinematics of the waves. All right. And we also discuss about the velocity of the waves. Okay, so in the last session, it was mostly theoretical stuff, and we did not get a lot of chance to do the numericals. Fine, and this is the last chapter also. So I want you to end the physics 11th in a good note. This chapter, let us solve it more, and let us solve more and more questions from this chapter so that we are very comfortable with it. Fine. So today's session is mainly problem practice. Okay. So I'll do some problems related to what we did in the last session, and then I will teach a little bit, and then again we will get into the problem practice. Fine. So that is the agenda for today. Now, what is going on in your school? Can anyone tell me what is happening in Rajajinagar and in what is that? NAFL. In Rajajinagar, SHM is going on. NAFL waves is going on. Okay. Oscillation just finished. Okay. So SHM just got over. Right, so now you know that you in your school oscillation just got over, and one more chapter to be finished. And immediately after chapter finishes, you have end semester exams or end of the year exam, whatever you want to call it. Right, so you can see how tight the entire grade 11 curriculum is, and even we have to finish the curriculum. You remember when we started? We started, I think, in the month of March. Right, and we are sitting on mid of January, so till end of the January, grade 11th will go on. So it is definitely not like how it was in grade 10th, where you complete the curriculum and revise 5 6 times, right? So that is the reason why I was telling you every class that do the assignments whenever you're doing it for the first time, do it properly that time itself, as if you'll not get time for the revision. Okay, so whatever it is, maybe some of you have listened initially, some of you have listened in the mid of the session and change your style, some of you are probably realizing now. Okay, but still you have one more year. Fine. In grade 12th, at least whatever mistakes you have done, do not carry that to the next year also. Fine. So keep that in mind. And anyways, we'll discuss about the grade 12th also, but after finishing the grade 11th curriculum. Grade 12 is a lot simpler than how grade 11 physics is. Okay. Anyways, so like what is the agenda? Let us start the problem practice. And before I project questions in front of a screen, I'll quickly write down all the equations, formulas, whatever we discussed in the last session, so that it's a ready reference for all of us. Okay. So we started the last session with wave equation. Okay. Wave equation is what? Y is equal to A sine of KX minus omega T plus phi. Now, looking at this equation, which direction the wave is traveling, can you tell me? Anyone? Everyone, which direction the wave is traveling? All of you. Right? It is in positive x direction. Good. Positive x direction. And which direction the particles of the mediums are oscillating? What is that direction in which the particles of the medium, they are oscillating? Y-axis, along the y-axis, right? So which wave it is? Which wave it is, transverse or longitudinal? It's a transverse wave. Okay, if I have to write down the longitudinal wave equation, okay, there the oscillation is happening along the x-axis only. The particles of the medium, they oscillate on the x-axis itself. Wave is also moving along the x-axis. So there is nothing in the y direction to track. So what do you track? You track how much away the particle is from the mean position. And that you are tracking in the transverse wave also. But since they are traveling along the y coordinate, so whatever movement they have, the particle, that is a y coordinate. But along the x-axis, their mean positions are at different locations. And here particle is oscillating, here it is oscillating, here it is oscillating, everywhere the particles are oscillating along the x-axis. So we introduce a variable s. S is the distance from the mean position along the x-axis only. And even the longitudinal wave equation looks similar. This is a longitudinal. So since wave equations are very similar to each other, we don't study kinematics of transverse and kinematics of longitudinal separately. It is same for both. Okay. So the wavelength, how will you write if these are the wave equation, how you write wavelength as lambda is equal to everyone, correct, 2 pi by k it is. Time period is what? Right, 2 pi by omega. Okay. And what is A? A is referred as amplitude. And velocity of the wave is what? V is equal to what? Good. Omega by k. So these things you can make out from the wave equation itself. Okay. And wave equation need not be sine or cosine waves. Fine. K is referred as wave number. If you are looking for the name, what is the name of K? K is called wave number. Okay, but that is just a name. Okay. Now, sine and cosine waves are the special kind of waves in which what happens, we have already discussed that, write down sine, cosine. If the sine or cosine wave is there, particles perform SHM. Okay, they perform SHM. All right. Now, if you differentiate y with respect to time, what do you get, everyone? At a particular location of x, if you take a derivative of y with respect to time, what it is? What does it represent? First, tell me that. Good. Now, how is the slope of the wave? It It's not slope, right? Slope is dy by dx. All right, this is velocity of the particle. Velocity of the particle. So this is minus of a omega cos of kx minus omega t plus phi. Fine. This can be written as minus of omega under root of a square minus a square into this. Okay, now what is the second term in the square root? This is what? This is y only. So you can see that the velocity of the particle is minus of omega root over a square minus y square. So it is like the way, like the SHM equation only, right? Omega under root a square minus x square was the SHM equation. The same way you get the particles equation also. So this proves that the particles are performing SHM. All right. Don't worry about the minus sign. If it would have been kx plus omega t, it would have been plus sign. It just tells you that which direction it moves, nothing other than that. Okay. Now, these are the kinematics related things. Suppose I ask you what is the acceleration of the particle, then what you will say? Acceleration of particle is what? Particle doing oscillation. So acceleration is omega square y. Okay, always keep in your mind that the particles are doing SHM. So the SHM equations are valid for the particle. But the wave is moving with velocity along the x-axis. So whatever wave does and whatever particles are doing are two different things. Okay, so this is the kinematics. Then in the last session, we spoke about the transverse wave speed on the string. What is the velocity? Root over t by mu. Correct. Okay. Then we spoke about longitudinal. Longitudinal wave inside a fluid. What will be the velocity? Correct. Under root b by rho. Bulk modulus, if you remember, is minus of v dp by dv. Okay. And in a fluid like air, bulk modulus is gamma times p for the sound wave. Okay. Now, there is also one equation related to longitudinal wave inside a solid. Okay. So sound can travel through the solid also. So the velocity of the sound on the solid would be under root Young's modulus by rho. That is the only change. Okay. Here the bulk modulus is of the air. There the Young's modulus is for the solid. So clearly, as expected, Young's modulus of solid is very large compared to bulk modulus of the air. So that's the reason why when the sound travels, it travels faster in the solid medium and slower in the air. And that is the reason why, I think I've given you this example already. That's the reason why when in the earlier times, if you have to understand the enemy is approaching you towards you or not, you put your ears on the ground. You'll hear the horses, you know, they are approaching you, your side. That is how you can determine much earlier. Maybe they are 15, 20 kilometers away, but when you put your ears on the ground, you'll be able to hear the tap of the horse foot. Because the sound travels faster on the solid medium, which is the ground. But in the air, if you try to hear it, it may not be very easy to hear, first of all, because of the wind blowing and everything. And also in the air, the speed of sound is a lot lesser. Okay, so these are the things that we discussed already. Let us solve questions now. Anyone has any doubts, quickly type in. Anyone wants to ask any doubts or anything you want to highlight, quick. Nothing, no doubts, doubtless. Okay, so here are the questions. Okay, somebody is asking something. Sir, what is the difference between phase difference and path difference? So, did you guys learn about the path difference in the school? If yes, then I can tell that. Did you guys learn that? Okay, it was there in the assignment. Okay. So, we will talk about it. I will discuss about it. Maybe after we are done with these 3-4 numericals, if I forget, you please remind me again. I will talk about it. Okay. Solve this question right now. A part, what is the answer? It's very straightforward, I think. A is what? All of you. 3 centimeter is A. B, wavelength. Okay, 6.28, are you guys able to recognize 6.28 is 2 times of pi? 6.28 is 2 times of pi. So the wave equation can be written like this, 3 sine of 2 pi into 0.5 is pi, pi x minus 314 t. Then 14 is 100 pi. Okay. So the answer for B is 2 pi by k. K is pi coefficient of x. So this is 2 centimeter. This is B. Now what is the answer for the C? Good. C is 1 by time period is the frequency. Omega divided by 2 pi. Omega is 100 pi divided by 2 pi. So this is 50 hertz. That's C. D, what is the answer? Everyone. Okay, I can see some of you already got it. Others? Velocity is omega by k, right? Omega is 100 pi, k is pi. So this is 100 centimeter per second or 1 meter per second. Okay, so this is how you do this. This is the school level kind of question. Let's go to the next one. Do this. In the previous question, our focus was what wave is doing. In this question, the focus is what particles are doing. Okay, particles perform SHM. A part is what? Part A. Vishal, Harshita got two different answers. Satyam. A part. Now, whenever a particle is doing SHM, the maximum speed in any SHM is what? Do you remember this? What is the formula? A omega, right? And you anyway know the formula is velocity is omega root over a square minus y square. So when y is zero, then only v is maximum. Omega a, that is at the mean position. Omega is 314, which is 100 times pi into 3. So that is 300 pi centimeter per second. So you have to keep a tab on the units also, okay? This is A. What is B? Satyam got something. Others? Vishal, okay. So you can see that if you differentiate y, keeping x constant, you get velocity. you again differentiate, you get acceleration. And if you already know that it is doing SHM, then ultimately you get an SHM equation that A is equal to minus of omega square y. This is SHM equation, right? Do you remember this? What is it doing SHM? So it boils down to finding what is the value of y at x equal to 6 centimeter and at t equal to 0.11 seconds. So that will be 3 times sine of at x equal to 6 centimeter. So this is pi. So it will be 6 pi minus 314 is 100 pi. 100 pi into 0.11 is 11 pi. So you will get minus of 3 sine 5 pi. What is the value of this? What's the value of this? Everyone, what is the value of this? 0, right? This is equal to 0. So y is 0, the acceleration is also 0. Is it clear to all of you? Type in. Okay, let's move on to the next question. Do this. Should I give hints? Satyam got something. The tension is due to the stress, and stress by strain is Young's modulus. Can do it now, others? All right. Okay, so all of these things are given to us. This is the string. It is clamped. There's a tension in this. Okay, if tension is T, then the stress is T divided by S, area of cross section. And if extension is delta L, strain is delta L by L. Fine. Now, you will see that when you write velocity, velocity is equal to root over T by mu. Okay. Mu is mass per unit length. So we are considering it as a uniform rod, uniform wire. So under root T divided by M by L. Okay. Now T is not given to us. Rather, they ask us to find delta L. So I can use that formula that sigma divided by epsilon is Young's modulus. So sigma is strain multiplied by the Young's modulus. Sigma is T by S. So T is delta L by L Y into S. Okay, this is T. So the speed of the wave is T you have to write delta L by L YS divided by M by L. So L is gone. Okay. So delta L will come out to be U square M divided by YS. Is this clear? Fine. These are all straightforward questions. Fine. They are very simple ones. Okay. Won't the string be extended initially? What do you mean by that? Somebody asking that, won't the string be extended initially? I didn't get what you mean. You should speak up. I'll unmute you. Speak.
Sir, in the formula for a strain, we have written delta L by L, but L must be natural length, right? But L is not natural length.
Yes. It
is given to us in the question.
Yes. We are assuming delta L is very small. And L plus delta L is roughly L only.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
All right. Next up. I'll initially itself give a small hint. The hint is frequency is same. Throughout the string. As it depends on the source. So it frequency below is equal to frequency top. You can roughly tell me the answer, or the expression also is fine. No one till now. Is there anyone about to get the answer? Okay, the first step is drawing a free body diagram. A rope of 12 meters and mass of 2 kg hangs from a rigid support, a mass of 6 kg. Transverse wave of some wavelength is produced here and it is moving upwards. You need to find out what will be the wavelength when it reaches the top. That is the question. Let's say this is point A, that is point B. Between point A and B, frequency is same. Is velocity same? Tension is different at different points, so the velocity is not same. Okay. Tension at point A is how much? Tension at point A is 6 g only. If you draw the free body diagram of 6 kg, this is TA, this is 6 g. So TA minus 6 g is 0. Fine. So TA is 6 g. If you take g as 10, TA is 60 newtons. Fine. At the top, what will be the tension? Let's say tension over there is TB. What is the value of TB? Okay, others? Right, it will be 80 newton, right? It will hold now 6 kg as well as the rope's mass also, which is 2 kg. Till now, many times we have been ignoring the mass of the rope. But here the mass of the rope is comparable to the mass of the block. We should not. That is 80 newton. Now tell me one thing. If this entire thing is in the lift and it is accelerating with accretion A, will the tension remain same or they be different? Will it remain same or different? Tension changes, right? So you need to draw the free body diagram every time. Don't assume that tension will be mg. Because it is all at rest, that is why tension is equal to mg. All right. So the velocity at point number A is root over TA by mu. And velocity at point number B is root over TB by mu. Fine. So velocity of and you know the frequency at A, let me write it as FA. Frequency at A is velocity of A divided by the wavelength at A. Frequency at B is velocity of B divided by wavelength at B. The frequencies are same. It is the same system. Same system cannot have two different frequencies. So VA by lambda A should be equal to VB by lambda B. So lambda B is equal to VB by VA times lambda A. When you do VB by VA, you'll get under root of TB by TA, which is root over 80 by 60. So 4 by 3, that multiplied by 0.06 meters. Clear to all of you? Right? All right. So these are the few questions I wanted to highlight. Now let us move forward with a new set of theory. And once the theory gets over, we'll again come back to the numericals. Okay. In case any one of you have any doubts, you can highlight. Okay, so the next thing that we are going to learn is the case 3 of superposition. Do you remember what are the first two cases? First two cases that we have learned previously, what was it? Case number one, amplitude is same and frequency and wavelength is also same. Case number two, amplitudes are different, frequency and wavelength, they are same. Okay. In both the cases, there was one thing that was common other than frequency and wavelength. What was one thing that is same throughout? Both are sine waves, okay. What else? Correct. Both are traveling in the same direction. Yes or no? In case number one and in case number two, both the waves were traveling in the same direction and they meet, and that's how things are happening. Okay. Now we are talking about a case in which the amplitude is same, frequency and wavelength is also same, but one is traveling in positive x direction, other is traveling in negative x direction, they meet. That is the case that we are going to discuss here. Okay, so let us do that. If this is the first wave, y1 is equal to a sine kx minus omega t. This wave is traveling in positive x direction. What is the second wave which is traveling in negative x direction? What should I write here? A times sine of correct kx plus omega t. This is traveling in the negative x direction. Okay, so I want you to simplify what will happen when both of them meet. Okay, so y will become y1 plus y2. Find out, let me know once you're done. Correct. Others? When you add, you can take A common, sine of kx plus omega t plus sine of kx minus of omega t. So this becomes a case of sine A plus sine B. Sine A plus sine B is what? 2 sine A plus B by 2 cos A minus B by 2, right? So it will become 2A sine of kx cos of omega t. This is what it becomes. Now, does it look like a wave equation to you, everyone? Does it look like a wave equation? It's not a wave equation. It is not a wave equation. Okay. But suppose you call this bracket term, suppose you call it as amplitude. So it will look like A cos of omega t. What does it look like? A cos omega t is which type of equation? Correct. Others? Which equation comes in your mind when, I mean, what is that name of the situation for which y is equal to A cos omega t is the equation? Correct. Others? It is the equation of the SHM. Okay. But here what is happening is that the amplitude A is equal to 2A sine of kx. It depends on x. All right. Amplitude depends on x. As in, all the particles are doing SHM only. Okay. But then not all the particles will be able to move up the same distance. So one particle will only go up to here. Other one can go up to there. So they will together go up, together comes down. So while they are oscillating, they have different amplitude at different x. At x equal to 1 centimeter, one amplitude. At x equal to 2 centimeters, some other amplitude. Okay. Will there be some positions x for which amplitude will become 0? Yes or no? If kx becomes 180 degree, kx is pi, sine of kx will become 0 or not? Right? So kx is pi. So x is pi by k. So at x equal to pi by k, amplitude is 0. So at that location, particle doesn't move at all because amplitude is 0. Then at x equal to 2 pi by k, amplitude is again 0. Fine? So what happens is something like this. This is x equal to 0. This is x equal to pi by k. X equal to 2 pi by k. See what is happening. When these two waves meet, this particle can go up and down like this. This can go up and down like that. The particles are oscillating at different amplitudes. Okay. Now, how it is different from a traveling wave? In a traveling wave, when the wave is moving forward, what happens is that there all the particles, they are oscillating at the same amplitude. All the particles can go down to a distance of A and can go up to a distance of A, but they are moving at different times like this. But here, what happens is different locations, the amount of distance the particle moves up is different. But all the particles together go up, all the particles together go down. So that is what is happening in this case. In traveling wave, when it is an actual wave equation, all the particles move, but they are not moving together. They are going like this. When this particle is down, that particle may be up and vice versa. All right. But in this case, all the particles together go up, together go down. All right. So this kind of situation, we call it a standing wave. All of you clear what exactly is happening here? Anyone has any doubts? Type in, is this clear? Okay. Do you want to see the standing wave? I'll just show you so that there is no confusion. As a bit before showing it to you, have you ever seen, let's say, a guitar string or something like this, which is tightly wound like that? Okay. You just pluck at the center. And have you ever seen such kind of vibration in the string? It shows as if an eye has been formed. Okay, you've seen it. Let me now show you the... this one. Even rubber band, yes, good.
So what we have here is a frequency generator. It's connected to what's called a wave driver. It's just a speaker. It's going to pump up and down at whatever frequency I set this guy to. When this guy pumps up and down, well, he sends a wave. He sends a wave down to this end, the wave reflects. The first one will be half this number, so 8.5.
I'll just show you, hold on. Look at this. This is a standing wave. All the particles, they are together moving up and down. Okay, this is what is happening. So you may be wondering that you need two waves. So where is the second wave that is traveling in the opposite direction? One wave, what happens? This machine is sending from here. This wave goes, hits an obstacle here. There is a reflection that happens. And second wave gets produced from here. This is incoming wave. And that's the reason why this is getting created. Fine. I will talk about that later in detail. So this is a standing wave. All right, and standing wave is a very, very common phenomena, at least in all the musical instruments. You will have standing wave only. Flutes, guitar, tabla, santur, all those instruments that people use, they work on the standing wave only. The working principle is standing wave. So that's why we are studying it. And let me now take this. equation, standing wave equation, and if amplitude, which is 2a sine of kx at a location x becomes zero, then that point doesn't move at all. Okay. So what are those points? 2a sine of kx should become zero. So from here, sine of kx becomes zero. And if it is zero, kx should become equal to n pi, or the x value would be n pi by k. N can be 0, 1, 2, like that. Fine. So at, let's say, x equal to 0, where n equal to 0, and x equal to 0. So at x equal to 0, you will have amplitude 0. That point is not moving at all. Then at x equal to pi by k, when you put n equal to 1, then you put n equal to 2, 2 pi by k also. Like that, you can keep on getting different values. And you'll get like infinite values. But practically speaking, your length of the string of the finite length. Okay, so you need to also see how much long the string you are using. It should not be that mathematically you're getting at 100 kilometer also there is amplitude equal to zero. But that 100 kilometer is not on the string. Right? If string is, let's say, 1 meter, so you need to stop substituting the value of n as soon as x becomes more than 1 meters, like that. Okay, these points, there's a special name to these points, they are called nodes. Okay, they are called nodes. Fine. Anyone has any doubts? No doubts? Okay, now the maximum possible amplitude is what? This amplitude 2a sine of kx. How much maximum possible amplitude this can have? Plus minus 2a. Right? What does minus mean? Minus only means that particle is going down. Okay, minus is like a sign convention. Minus a and plus a are same. Okay. So wherever 2a sine kx becomes equal to plus minus 2a, at that location, maximum possible amplitude happens. So for that, sine of kx should be equal to plus minus 1. So what is the value of x for that? Kx for that? What kx should be equal to? Everyone, kx should be equal to what? Generic solution to tell me like this, n pi, in terms of n, what it should be, okay? Plus minus n pi by 2k. What if n equal to 2? Can n be even number? Can n be even number if you say n pi by 2k? It cannot be an even number, it has to be odd, right? So if it has to be odd, so make it an odd digit like this, 2n plus 1, pi by 2, like this, okay? So at this location, where x is equal to 2n plus 1, pi by 2k, maximum possible, amplitude happens. These are called antinodes. Fine. Okay. Now look at this. X equal to, all of you again write it, n pi by k. They are nodes, and x equal to 2n plus 1 pi by 2k antinodes. Okay, so for nodes, the value of x, write down few values: 0, put n equal to 1, pi by k, 2 pi by k, 3 pi by k, and so on. Okay, for antinodes, value of x, put n equal to 0, you'll get pi by 2k. Then n equal to 1, 3 pi by 2k. Then 5 pi by 2k. And so on. Now, when you look at the locations of nodes and antinodes, what can you make out? One clear observation. What do you think it is? Everyone, good. Look at this. I mean, whatever you have said, that is also correct. But I was looking at a simpler observation. So look at this. Between 0 and pi k, what is the point? Pi by 2k or not? That comes in middle of this. 3 pi by 2k comes in the middle of these two. 5 pi by 2k comes in the middle of these two. Right? Similarly, pi by 2k comes middle of these two. 2 pi by k comes middle of these two. So it implies what? It implies that between two nodes, one antinode is present, and between two antinodes, one node is present. Clear to all of you? Anyone has any doubts? Anyone has any doubts? Any doubts? Type in. Okay. All right. So now a little bit of hint I have already given you how the standing wave is created. You need what? You need one wave traveling in one direction and the other wave should travel in the opposite direction. Okay. What is the best way to create a wave that travels opposite to your direction of the wave? What is the best way? Best way to do that? I've already told you. What is that way? You need two waves, right? One wave you can create. How will you create the other wave having the same frequency which travels in the opposite direction? Correct. Reflection. Reflection is the way. Okay. Whenever I teach reflection, one scenario comes in my mind. Like when I was at your age, I used to sit in the balcony and study in the late evenings. So every time, you know, our building was very near to the boundary wall of the society. So every late evening, you know, it is a routine of there was a dog, a stray dog, to come near the wall and he start barking. And his own voice gets reflected from the wall and he hears his own voice. So that dog used to think that there is another dog on the other side of the wall. So he keeps on barking for hours every day. So one fine day I have to put water on him so that he doesn't come back. But then that is how it happens. Okay, so reflection is very common phenomena. And you know, if reflection happens a lot, then it can create echo and you don't like to, like for example, theaters, when they are created, special attention is given to acoustics so that the sound doesn't get reflected again and again multiple times and you hear echo. So all those things are very important. Anyways, so write down reflection of the wave. Can generate. Standing wave. Okay, it can generate the standing wave. Now, we will see the different cases of the reflection because it's not that same kind of reflection happens everywhere and everything is similar. So let's say how the reflection happens. For that, we have to take examples. Okay, so we will take example of a string, the wave on a string. So write down case number one. One end of the string is fixed. Okay. Let's say this. Some other color. This end is clamped. Clamp. From here, you are sending a wave. Okay. This wave moves forward. All right. When this wave moves little bit forward, let's say it goes there. Okay. So, what happened to this point when it was here? Later when wave moved forward, what happened to that point? Everyone. Right? When this wave became a dotted line as it moves forward, what happens to that? Correct. It moves up. Okay. So if wave has to move forward, the point has to move up wherever it goes. Okay. So wave is trying to lift the rope in upward direction everywhere. So let's say the wave reaches here at the end. The wave has reached over there. This is at t equal to 0, t equal to t1. The wave has reached here. Okay, this is, let's say point P. Okay. So what this wave is trying to do with point P? Tell me. what does this wave is trying to do with point P? Point P is on the wall. The wave is trying to do what? It wants to lift it, right? It wants to lift it, right? So the wave is trying to lift the point P on the wall upwards so that it can move forward. Pretty simple. That is what everywhere the wave is trying to do. Right? This is what the wave is trying to do. Now, point P can't move. It is a part of wall. So wave cannot move the wall. So the wave is applying force on the point P, or you can say the wave, or indirectly, let's say you're saying that the rope is applying force on the wall in upward direction, right? Wave is riding on the rope. Rope is fixed to the wall. So the rope is trying to pull the wall in upward direction. So what wall will do? What wall will do? What wall will do? Correct. Good. So according to Newton's third law, it will apply equal and opposite force. So the wall will apply equal and opposite force on rope, basically downwards. This is what it tries to do. Fine. Now, when rope is applying force on the wall, wall can't move. But when wall is applying force on the rope, will rope move or not? Rope will move. And which direction it is applying? Downward force. So what happens is, ultimately, this kind of wave gets generated. The wave gets inverted like this and start moving this way. Clear to all of you how this wave has generated? You're pulling the rope down, so that wave gets created, the downward wave is getting created, and it is moving in the opposite direction. Clear? Type in quick. Is it clear? Okay. So the incoming wave equation, let's say, is A sine of kx minus omega t. The incoming wave. All right. The reflected wave equation, what that will be? Tell me. Will it be A sine kx plus omega t? Does this sound correct? Correct. Then what is the difference between this wave traveling in this way or that wave traveling in this way? Is there any difference or not? There's a difference. There is a difference. Okay. So what is that difference? The difference is of the phase, actually. There's a phase difference between these two waves. How much is the phase difference? Look at this. If you connect it like this, it's a sine wave, right? So this angle, let's say, is zero. This is pi. This is 2 pi. Okay. So that point, this point is pi angle away of this point. So it was zero and suddenly it has become pi. So all the corresponding points are ahead by pi. So you can say that there is a phase that gets introduced plus pi. Okay. This is also referred as hard reflection. Hard reflection. So you will study about it next year also in wave optics. Hard reflection introduces a phase of pi. Not only the wave is traveling in opposite direction, it gets inverted also during the hard reflection. Okay. Now this example that we have taken, by the way, is the transverse wave. Let us see if something similar happens with the longitudinal wave, like for example sound when it gets reflected. So for longitudinal wave, there, let's say this obstacle and longitudinal wave is nothing but compression and refraction. Somewhere the air will get compressed more, some places the air will get compressed lesser, like this. Compression, refraction, like that. I've shown it to you, right? So wherever it hits the obstacle, at that point the air will get compressed or will get elongated. The compression or refraction. What will happen when it hits the wall, at the point where it touches the wall? Compression, right? It is compression that happens, right? So now when it gets reflected off, after reflection, what will happen? The compression will remain compression or will it become refraction? What do you think? After reflection, will it remain compression or it will be refraction? Just imagine the spring is getting compressed over here, and when it push it back, it is anyway getting compressed from this side. You are putting from that side also after reflection. Will it get compressed or not? I mean, why are you saying refraction? Some of you are saying refraction. It will get compressed. Okay, so refraction won't happen. All right, that is unlike how it happened in the transverse wave. In transverse wave, the wave gets inverted. Inversion means whatever the compression suddenly becomes refraction. But now, even after reflection, compression remains compression at that point. Okay. So with this, if incident wave, incoming wave equation is A sine kx minus omega t, the reflected one will be simply A sine kx plus omega t. No phase change happens. Fine. So in a longitudinal wave, reflection creates no phase change. Okay, so after reflection, I will also talk about the path difference, or that just like phase difference, there is something called path difference also. But right now, let me complete the reflection part of it. Anyone has any doubts here? Are you able to visualize the compression? Even after it get reflected, there will be compression near the wall. Type in. You have to visualize it. All right. Okay. Now let us see the case two. These longitudinal wave and transverse wave, they were encountering the hard reflection. We have seen what happens after the hard reflection with the transverse and with the longitudinal wave. So let's see what will happen to the transverse wave in the soft reflection. First of all, we should know what is soft reflection, right? So case number two. Soft reflection. What it is, we will take an example of a string to explain that. This is a scenario, the end of the rope. There's a ring, a massless ring that can move up and down. A massless ring can move up and down. Okay. And from here, you are, let's say, sending a wave like this. This wave move forward. Okay. Now, when this wave goes over there, it will try to move the ring in upward direction. Will the ring move or not? Will the ring move? It will move. So it will be like this. When the wave reaches over here, the ring will be like this. When the wave reaches here, the ring is like that. And slowly wave disappears and the ring comes here. Right? Initially, the ring will move up and then ring will come down as the wave is passing through the wall. But when the ring is doing this, it is as if somebody stood on the other side, took the ring and did like this. So that movement of ring, will it create a wave that way or not? It is as if somebody standing on the other side, took the ring and did like that. Will it create a wave? It create a wave itself, right? Because the ring is moving up and down. All right. And hence reflection happens. But now when the reflection is happening, the reflected wave that get generated will be in upward direction only. It is like this. Phase change doesn't happen in the soft reflection. Okay. So if the incoming wave is A sine of KX minus omega T, the reflected one is A sine of KX plus omega t. Fine. This is a soft reflection. Okay. Now tell me, is the light transverse wave or longitudinal wave? What it is? Light wave. Light is correct. Light is transverse wave. Okay. Light is a transverse wave. So does the reflection happen with the light? Of course, yes. Reflection does happen with the light. So whatever we have learned, same thing you can apply to the light also. All right. And when we talk about reflection from the light, have you observed that when you take a transparent piece of glass, you can not only see on the other side, but you can see your faint reflection also on that transparent glass. Have you observed that? Right? Another example could be, suppose you are inside the car. When you're inside the car, you can not only see outside the car, but also your own on that mirror. Okay, so why I'm telling you this is that whenever there is, let's say, light goes from one medium to the other medium, it is not that entire light passes through the other medium. Some part of it gets reflected, and because of that, you are able to see yourself, and some part of it gets transmitted. Got it? So it is not 100% refraction all the time. So 80% will be refracted, 20% will be reflected. So like that, it happens. Fine, so keep that in mind. So coming back to the reflection of the light. So first of all, reflection from the mirror is considered to be hard reflection. It's a hard reflection. Okay. Then, if the light is in denser medium, okay, and it is going to the rarer medium, reflection from rarer to denser medium. Did I say opposite of it? I think. Anyway, since I've written reflection from rarer to denser medium. Suppose the light is in the oil and the light enters the water. So oil is rarer medium. So light is trying to go to the denser medium from the rarer one. And if reflection is happening over there, that is a case of, again, hard reflection. Why I'm saying hard reflection? Because hard reflection means a phase change of pi. And phase can play a big role. When two waves superimpose, it is a phase difference that matters. Okay? Reflection from denser to rarer. This is a soft reflection case. Okay, so for light, we are not going to study much. We just, since we are talking about reflection, the best reflection which we are aware of in our day-to-day life is reflection of the light. So I thought I could just tell you a little bit about the light reflection also. Okay. So these are the cases, and you have a chapter called wave optics, in which you are anyway going to discuss the superposition of the light waves later. Okay, somebody is asking, sir, in the soft reflection, there won't be phase difference. Yes, there won't be phase difference. The velocity of the light changes, but the direction of velocity of light changes, but the phase difference remains zero. Okay. All right. So now somebody was asking the path difference also. Phase difference we have seen, right? So I'll just talk about the path difference over here. It's a slightly off topic, but let me complete it. So two waves are there. Y1 is equal to A sine of KX minus omega T. Y2 is equal to A sine of KX minus omega T plus phi. Now, what is the phase difference between them? Everyone, what is the phase difference? Phase difference is phi. Okay, it is phi. Path difference is what? Path difference is pretty simple. Path difference is difference. Path difference is equal to distance traveled by wave one minus distance traveled by wave two. Path difference is the difference in the paths. Okay. Now, why it is so important? Because the distance traveled can itself create the phase difference. For example, let me take an example on the other slide. I'm first telling you why it is important. What it is, I'm coming to it. Let's say this is the wave, one wave, and this is the other wave. Okay. Now at the start, when both started at t equal to zero, what are the phase difference? What does it look like? Is there any phase difference? When both started, zero. It is zero. At t equal to zero, no phase difference. T equal to zero. Both the waves are moving. Suppose the above wave has reached here. This is point P. This is point Q. Now tell me, is there a phase difference between these two points, P and Q? They may not have reached at the same time, but is there a phase difference or not? What does it look like? Looks like, right? P and Q are not same as A and B. A and B, they are very similar. There is no phase difference. P and Q, there is a phase difference. And why there is a phase difference? The reason is wave one has traveled more distance than wave two. Wave one traveled more distance compared to wave two. That is a reason. So how do you take into that? How do you account for that? Okay, let's see. This is a phase of zero. All of you agree? This is pi. It's a sine wave. This is 2 pi, 3 pi, 4 pi. And distance is traveled along this line. So can you correlate distance in terms of phase? Think of anything. Can you correlate distance with the phase? Like if you travel this much distance, this much phase will be added up. Like that, can you think of? Correct. Harshita got it? So you can see that one wavelength distance corresponds to 2 pi phase. Yes or no? One wavelength from here to there, it is 2 pi. There to there. Every time you travel a distance of lambda, 2 pi phase difference will get added up. Okay. So if let's say above wave traveled a distance of L1, so the phase of the above wave will be 2 pi by lambda is phase per unit length multiplied by L1. Below wave, the phase will be distance traveled is let's say L2, 2 pi by lambda into L2. So the phase difference between P and Q, phi 1 minus phi 2, becomes 2 pi by lambda multiplied by L1 minus L2. So if you multiply the path difference with 2 pi by lambda, you will get a phase difference. And vice versa, if you multiply lambda by 2 pi to the phase difference, you will get the path difference. Is it clear to all of you? Now it is clear, path difference. Everyone. Type in everyone. Is this clear? Is L1, L2 a distance move in the same time? Yes, you can say that. I can show you a situation, but is this clear, whatever I have written here? Okay, I'll just show you a situation in which it happens. Suppose this is a screen. Two openings. These two openings, light can enter. Okay? So the light enters from here, it travels here, there. From here, when light enters, it travels there to meet. So suppose these two light have, these light is a wave, so it travels as a wave and meets at point P from these two points. It can meet here also. So the path difference here is zero, but path difference when these two meet over here is not zero. Is it clear to all of you? The wave two has traveled more distance compared to wave one when they meet. Satyam, is it clear? Okay, so there are a lot of such scenarios. We are going to learn all this in grade 12th actually. Path difference was not as important in 11th as it is in 12th. But since it was there in the assignment, we discussed it. Is there anything in the assignment that you have seen and we haven't discussed? Anything else? No? Ajay, let me first ask, how many of you have tried the assignment? Good. All right. Okay, someone is asking if phase difference is zero, it's not compulsory that path difference is zero. If phase difference is zero, phase difference could be zero or 2 pi or 4 pi. It is similar because after every 2 pi phase, things get repeated. Okay, so if you say zero, it should be exact zero, then path difference should be exactly zero. But if you're like, phase difference can be 2 pi, it is same as phase difference zero. Then the path difference is lambda, because lambda corresponds to 2 pi. 4 pi, then path difference is 2 times lambda. Okay? All right, so let us move forward. coming back to the standing wave, how do you find out if it is 0 or 2 pi? Don't worry, it will be there in the question, like that scenario. It will be there, you'll understand. Okay. Like for example, here, in this case, if L2 minus L1 is lambda, the distance difference is lambda, the phase difference is 2 pi. If it is, it comes out to be 2 lambda, phase difference is 4 pi. But we assume that while entering these two do not have any phase difference. Got it? While the light enters from here, 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 initially there is no phase difference. If initially there is a phase difference, you need to account for that also. Initial phase difference plus final phase difference. That is a total phase difference. So more and more doubts you ask, it becomes okay. So let's move forward. And what is the time right now? 15 minutes for the break. We will again come back to this standing wave. Okay. So when standing wave gets created, when two waves travel in the opposite direction, they superimpose. All right. And the best possible way of superimposing, or best possible way to create a wave that travels opposite direction to the initial wave, is by having reflection. Okay. Reflection, when it happens, there can be many scenarios. In our curriculum, a couple of standard scenarios are there. Let us discuss them. Okay. So now things will be pretty simple. Less mathematical, more conceptual. Write down standing wave on strain. That is what we are going to discuss. But when we discuss standing wave on a strain, there are some thumb rules that we need to keep in our mind. Point number one is, if a point is clamped, you are holding that point, you're not allowing that point to move at all, then what that point should be? Then automatically that point becomes what? Then that point must be what? Node, antinode, what it is? A node. Node is a point having zero amplitude. Should be node. Okay. And if a point, this is like a constraint things. If a point is free to move, if the end point, okay, not just any point, the end point of the string is free to move, then that must be antinode. Maximum possible amplitude of that point. If the end of the string is free to move. So there are two cases. Case number one, both ends are clamped. Case number two, one is clamped, other is free to move. We cannot have case three where both are free to move. Then how will you have a string, right? It'll just fall down. So case number one, is when both the strings, sorry, both ends are clamped. Okay. Like this. If both ends are clamped, can you draw largest possible wavelength here? What should be the largest possible wavelength so that these two points are the nodes? Because A and B cannot move. Can you draw largest possible wavelength standing wave here? Okay, this is one full wavelength. This is one full wavelength. Okay, so let me know once you're done. Done? Okay. So all of you agree that this is the largest possible wavelength you can have. Because you have to make sure A and B are the nodes. Is it clear to all of you? Largest possible wavelengths in the standing wave. Type in, is this clear? Okay. So if wavelength is lambda, what is the relation between wavelength and length of the string? Lambda and L, what is the relation? Lambda by 2 is equal to L, half of the wavelength is L, right? So the wavelength is 2L, and if tension the string is T, mass per unit length is mu. The velocity is under root of T by mu. The velocity of the wave. Velocity of the wave has nothing to do with what wave is doing. Velocity of the wave is always under root T by mu. Okay. It is a medium's property that drives the velocity of the wave, which is under root T by mu. So the frequency is velocity divided by wavelength. This will be 1 by 2L root over T by mu. Okay. So this is the largest possible wavelength. And this frequency is what? Smallest possible, or this is also largest possible? Smallest possible. Smallest possible, right? And anything which is smallest possible, in physics, we call that as fundamental unit. Okay? So, since it is the smallest possible frequency that is possible, we call it fundamental frequency. Okay? So this is the fundamental frequency. Now, fundamental frequency, just write fundamental, okay? Writing it like fundamental is, it's like the common name. You have learned the nomenclature in organic chemistry, right? There you have two kinds of nomenclature. One is common name, other is IUPAC name. Similarly, here also you have two names for the same thing. You can call it fundamental, or you can call it in a more formal manner, first harmonic. Yes. Okay. Now let's see the next possible wavelength. Can you all draw the next possible wavelength? We have drawn the largest possible wavelength. Can you think of next possible wavelength having A and B as nodes? Let me know once you're done. Done? Okay. So do you all agree that the next possible wavelength is this? Yes or no? It should be this only. There is no other way. So here the wavelength is half of the previous wavelength, right? Between A and B, it is one full wavelength, one full wavelength. So now the length is the wavelength only. Lambda is the length. The velocity of the wave is root over T by mu. So the frequency is velocity divided by wavelength. So 1 by L root over T by mu, which is 2 by 2L. Why I'm writing 2 by 2L, you'll understand. Is you can see it is the frequency is 2 times the previous frequency. All right. The name is first overtone. First overtone means after fundamental, whatever comes is first overtone. And it is second harmonic. Why is called second harmonic? It is second harmonic not because it is the second possible frequency. It is second harmonic because it is 2 times the first frequency possible. Okay, that is why it is second harmonic. So can you tell me the formula for the nth harmonic frequency? What do you think that should be? Can you see some pattern here? Nth harmonic, what will be the frequency? Correct. N by 2L root over T by mu for the nth harmonic. Okay. Fine. All right. Now, what is the time? Should we take a break now or later? Let's complete one thing, then we'll take a break. Okay. Case number two is one end is free to move. The situation is like this. Is like that. You can move this point up and down. So you can create a wave. So can you draw the first possible standing wave here? A should be node. It is fixed. A is fixed. You're not moving A up and down. Sorry about that. A is fixed. B is free to move. So the first possible standing wave, how does it look like? Let me know once you're done. Done. Okay. So the other end should be antinode. So this is the first possible standing wave. How many times this wavelength it is? The length L. This is lambda by 4. 1/4 of the wavelength it is. So lambda is 4L. Okay. Velocity is root over T by mu. So the frequency is 1 by wavelength, which is 1 by 4L. Multiply that by under root T by mu. This frequency is called the fundamental frequency. There is also the first harmonic. First one is always first harmonic. Now, try drawing the next possible frequency and derive the expression yourself. Let me know once you are done. Draw the next possible frequency. Done. Okay, good. It will be like this, okay? This point mandatorily have to be antinode and that point mandatorily have to be a node, okay? How many times this wavelength it is? Lambda by 4. 3 times lambda by 4, the length is. So 3 lambda by 4 is length L. So lambda is 4L by 3. Velocity is root over T by mu. So the frequency is velocity divided by the wavelength. So 3 divided by 4L root over T by mu. Okay. So it is called first overtone. Which harmonic it is? Which harmonic it is, everyone? No, this is not second harmonic. How many times this frequency is of the fundamental or the first harmonic? How many times it is? 3 times. So this is third harmonic. So you can see that even harmonics don't exist in this case. Okay, so you know, you take a string, try to create a standing wave. It is not that you can have any frequency possible. The minimum frequency for the standing wave is the fundamental. Next possible frequency for standing wave is this first overtone. You cannot have any other frequency of standing wave between these two. So that is why these frequencies are important. All right. I'll just give you one situation here. Tell me, can you draw the next possible frequency? Second overtone. First overtone, you have already drawn. Draw the second overtone and find out the frequency. Everyone, try it. Done. This point have to be antinode. The rightmost point, leftmost point have to be node. So this is what you will get. Type in. Is this clear? Next possible frequency is something like this. Everyone, type in. So how many times the wavelength, the length is? Count lambda by 4. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 times lambda by 4. Okay. So 5 lambda by 4 is L. So lambda is 4L by 5. So again, when you see the frequency, it is 5 by 2L. Even harmonic doesn't exist. 4 by 2L doesn't exist. This is the second overtone and fifth harmonic. Okay. So if you're looking for a generic equation, 2N minus 1th harmonic, the frequency of that is 2n minus 1 divided by 4l root over t by mu. Yes, there is a 4 in the denominator. Okay, so let us take a break now at least. Okay, meet after the break. All right, can you hear me? All right. So let us proceed. Next is the, you know, when we study the longitudinal wave, it is the outcome of two waves moving in opposite directions. Fine. Now these two waves, when they move, they can be transverse wave as well as longitudinal waves. But the example that we have taken is the example of a transverse wave, because a wave on a string, that example we took. Similar to what we did just now, there can be longitudinal standing wave also. But longitudinal standing wave, like sound, so standing wave of sound, okay? So that can be inside, let's say, a pipe. It can't be on a string. Fine. So we will take next example for a standing wave as. Okay, I have to show you a quick video, which I forgot. This video, okay, I wanted to show it to you because we have learned enough to understand this one. So just all of you. See this?
It's connected to what's called a wave driver. It's just this.
Can you hear him?
It's going to pump up and down at whatever frequency I set this guy to. When this guy pumps up and down, well, he sends a wave.
Is it audible? Whatever the sound is coming from the video. Okay, now listen to him.
He sends a wave down to this end, the wave deflects, comes back. Now, if I set it to just any old frequency, let me just turn this on. Well, yeah, let's go higher. So it's sending waves back and forth, but these waves are out of sync, if you like. They're not exhibiting consistently constructive or destructive interference at any one point. But if I set it here, for example,
which harmonic it is? This one is which harmonic? Correct.
I have what's called a standing wave. That is the wave that's sent down and reflects, constructively interferes with the next wave that comes down right at this point. Now the waves that reflect, that come down and reflect, destructively interfere with the incoming waves right here. And that's called a node. I can touch it and it still is working. So the node is not moving. Here it's moving up and down, and here it's moving up and down. And we'll see that in a second with the high speed camera.
You can see all the particles, they are together moving up, together going down.
So here we have what's called the second harmonic. It's the second possibility for a standing wave for a string that's held at both ends. Because notice, this is a node, and the middle's a node. So we have three nodes for this wave. Now, like I said, second harmonic, well, what's the first one? The first one will be half this number, so 8.5. And there we go. It's basically the scenario of a jump. Now, I can find any of the other, all of the other harmonics are multiples of this number. So we just saw that two times this number was the second harmonic, or the second possibility. Well, if I go three times this number, I should get the third harmonic. Well, three times 8.5, I guess, what is that? 25.5? And there we go. So that's the third harmonic. How many wavelengths is this? Well, it's 1.5. 1.5 wavelengths. And it's easier to see in high speed. So check out this shot with the high speed camera and verify for yourself that it is 1.5 wavelengths. So again, third harmonic, 1.5 wavelengths. Well, let's go to the sixth harmonic. The sixth harmonic will just be double this frequency. So we go up to 50. And there we go. That's the sixth.
So you can see like that, you can keep on increasing and get the various frequencies. Okay, so that was a video I wanted to show you. But that was a long, that was a transverse standing wave on a string. Now we are talking about longitudinal standing wave. Just a second, someone is calling. Write down longitudinal standing waves. On pipe. Now here also you can have different cases. And just like we had some thumb rules with the string that the clamp will be node and the end which is free to move will be the empty node. Similarly here, we'll follow these two rules. The first one is the open end of the pipe. Open end acts as empty node. Okay. Whereas the closed end acts as node. So node is nothing but you can say compression zone. So wherever it hits the wall, that's a compression, right? And this is rarefaction. Okay, so let's do that now. We'll have case number one. Both ends open right now. Both end open. Now, can you draw a wave having both ends open? Sorry, having the antinodes on both the ends. Draw the largest possible wavelength having both ends as antinodes, because both ends are open. Let me know once you're done. Done? Good. So I hope all of you understand that this is the maximum possible wavelength. Okay. You can't have longer wavelength than this. All right. Now, some of you can say that why not this frequency like this? I mean, you can't draw straight line. Straight line is not a wave. It has to be some sort of curve. Okay. So we have drawn it like this. My question to you is, does it look like a longitudinal wave? Does it look like a longitudinal wave? This longitudinal wave doesn't look like this. Longitudinal wave is the rarefaction, compression, Rarefaction, compression, it is like this. Okay, but then it is very difficult to visualize standing wave if you draw longitudinal wave like this, right? So to visualize it properly, we are drawing longitudinal wave as if it is transverse wave. Okay, mathematically both are same, that's why. So if length is L, this is lambda by 4. So 2 times lambda by 4, lambda by 2 is L. So lambda is 2L. Okay. Now what is the velocity of sound? Velocity of the wave is what in this pipe? Everyone, velocity of the wave in this pipe, how will you write? Good. Under root of b by rho. This is a longitudinal wave. So the frequency velocity divided by wavelength 1 by 2L root over b by rho. This is called fundamental frequency and first harmonic. Now I want you to draw the next possible wavelength. Let me know once you're done. Two ends have to be antinodes. Done, right? So all of you understand that it will be like this. Type in next possible wavelength will be like this. Is it clear? Type in. Right? So if this is the next possible wavelength, can you tell me what is the formula for the frequency if length is L, bulk modulus is B and density is rho? Tell me what is the formula. Type in. Wavelength is how much? You can see lambda by 4 times lambda by 4 is L. So the wavelength is L only. So 1 by wavelength, which is L root over B by rho, which is 2 by 2L. This first overtone. Second harmonic. Okay. Similarly, you can write down nth harmonic. It will be n by 2L under root b by rho. This is nth harmonic. Which overtone this will be? Everyone, this is nth harmonic. Which overtone this will be? N minus 1th overtone. Okay, good. So this is the case in which both ends are open. Now let's say one end is closed, other end is open. Theory is about to get over. Just 2-3 minutes, theory is over. Then we will do numericals only. Okay, so pay utmost attention. Case number 2. One end is closed, other one is open. Let's say like this. If length is L, Okay, bulk modulus is B, density is rho. Can you tell me the fundamental frequency? What is the formula? Do it yourself. Largest possible wavelength. Draw it. This end must be a node. This end must be antinode. Satyam got it. Others? So all of you, I hope you agree that fundamental frequency, the largest possible wavelength is this. And this is 1/4 of the wavelength, right? So lambda by 4 is L. So lambda is 4L. The frequency is 1 by 4L under root B by rho. Fundamental first harmonic. I want you to do the same thing for the next possible frequency. Do the same thing for the next possible frequency. Derive it your own. You will see that if you do that, numericals will appear very, very simple. Okay, Satyam got it. Others? Tanvi got it. All right, so I hope all of you understand. You'll get this. This. Smriti also got it. This is what? 1, 2, 3. 3 times lambda by 4 is L. So lambda is 4L by 3. The frequency is 1 by lambda, which is 3 by 4L under root B by rho. This is first overtone. Which harmonic it is? Correct. Third harmonic. Three times the first harmonic is third harmonic. So even harmonic doesn't exist here also. Even harmonics don't exist. Okay. So if you want to write the generic expression, 2n minus 1 divided by 4l, under root B by rho. This is 2n minus 1th harmonic. Okay, these are the final expressions. You can choose to memorize it, the final expression, or whenever numerical comes, you can quickly, derive it. It'll hardly take, let's say, 5-6 seconds. All right. So if you have a habit of quickly analyzing and deriving it, you'll never go wrong. If you memorize it, probably memory can trick you sometimes. Fine. All right. So there are certain situations for pipes. Last bit of theory I'm talking about. For pipes, whenever we deal standing wave with the pipes, there are some end corrections. Okay, what is that end correction? The end correction is the antinode gets formed roughly at a distance of 0.3 times diameter away from the pipe. It doesn't get formed. Antinode, when you draw it like this, we assume that antinode gets formed over there. But in reality, what happens is the antinode gets formed slightly above. This distance is 0.3D. This is the correction, which many times you'll ignore it. For school exams, they don't consider end correction at all. But I have seen in compu exams, they will give you the diameter of the pipe so that you consider the end corrections. If they are giving you diameter of the pipe, then they want you to consider the end correction. So that is the idea here. So does it mean that our formulas and equations, everything gets changed? The answer is no. All you have to do is this. If the pipe is open from one side, one end, then you just write the effectively the length would be as if it is original length plus 0.3 times diameter. In all the derivations, rather than considering it a length of L naught, you treat it as if it is L naught plus 0.3D length pipe. Okay. And if pipe is open from both ends, then you have to consider the end correction both sides. So consider it as L naught plus 2 times 0.3D. It is L naught plus 0.6D. Consider this as the effective length. As if your length of the pipe is not L naught. It is L naught plus 0.6D. Okay, so whatever theory I have to do today, I'm done with that. Anyone has any doubts on theory, whatever we did since the start? Quickly type in. Think about it. Any clarification, any doubts? No doubts. Okay, so looks like all of you will get all the questions correct. So let us solve some questions. Fine, we have about 40 minutes, so we can do a lot of questions. Do this. Try solving it. resonates with 420 hertz or 490 hertz means that frequency is 420 hertz. Resonate means the same frequency it has. Okay, so don't worry about that. Satyam got some answer. Satyam, check for the calculation mistake. Ajay, can you can solve first for this? Find which harmonic 420 hertz is. Which harmonic it is? Second harmonic, third harmonic, fourth harmonic, what it is? No one else? Okay, I'll do it now. So we know that the frequency, if it is tied from both the sides, the frequency is n by 2l under root t by mu. Okay, so this is, let's say, 420. If this is 420, 490 would be what? Instead of n, what should I write? It is the next higher frequency, right? Next higher frequency. So instead of n, you'll have n plus 1. Are these two equations clear to all of you? Type in. Okay, now my question is, what is n then? How do you find n? Divide these two. You'll get n divided by n plus 1 equal to 42 by 49, which is 6 by 7. So what is n? It is an integer, n has to be 6. Okay. Once you get n to be equal to 6, now you can substitute the value of n over here, and 6 by 2l root over t by mu, right? T is 450, mu is 5 into 10 to the power minus 3. This you can equate to 420. This is what you did, Satyam. You can do whatever answer will be. Answer you should get is this: 2.14 meters. Okay. This is how you solve this question. All right. We'll move to the next one now. This is a simple one. Everyone, solve it. Okay, Satyam got something. Let me check the answer. Check for the silly error. What is that something which will be same for both the pipes? One thing that is same for both. Velocity of the sound. Good. Velocity of the sound will be same. So the fundamental frequency of the closed organ pipe. So it is closed from one side. Let's say length is L1. Fundamental frequency is 1 by 4L times root over B by rho. Okay. Now open from both the sides. Length is L2, let's say. First overtone as in second harmonic of an open organ pipe. Second harmonic is like this, right? Where wavelength is the length. So that is, this is mu1, this is mu2, for L1, 1 divided by L2, under root B by rho. Okay, both are equal, right? Both are equal. So mu1 is equal to mu2 this. So L2 is equal to 4L1. Length of open pipe is 60. So L2 is 60, so L1 is 60 by 4, which is 15 centimeter. All of you understand where you made silly error? Type in those who got the wrong answer. You should not have got the wrong answer because these are very, very simple questions. Fine. You just cannot afford to lose marks in this. Whenever you write any compa exams, even Kemon test for that matter, have you ever observed that in a Kemon test also, at least 50 to 60% questions are very simple. But the problem is we do not know where they are. So you need to find them and solve it. and then go to the difficult ones. So easy questions are more important for you. Give them more respect and be more attentive. Never make silly error in an easy question. Okay. Next one is a question from your textbook. Solve this. This I have taken from your NCERT. Guys, do you know tomorrow you have chemistry session? Do you know this? Tomorrow chemistry class will happen. Sir has told last week, right? Tomorrow is extra chemistry session. Okay, please come to the class. We want to finish the curriculum well before your exam. So that is the reason why tomorrow will be extra chemistry session. He will send the reminder anyways in the group. Okay. Vishal got the answer. Others? Okay, so some of you have answered already. Let's see if you have made silly error this time or not. A pipe of length 30 centimeter, so 0.3 meters is the length, is open both ends. Frequency that is given to us is 1100 hertz. Which is 1.1 kilohertz. Which harmonic mode it runs? It is open at both ends. So N by 2L into speed. Speed is directly given to us. We don't need to find out. This should be equal to 1100. Okay. Length is 0.3. So you'll see that N by 2 into 330 is equal to 330. So N becomes equal to 2. So it is second harmonic. Okay. It's a second harmonic. Will the resonance with the same source be observed if one end of the pipe is closed? How do you find that? If one end of the pipe is closed, whatever is the frequency, that frequency must match with this formula, 2n minus 1 by 4 into the velocity v, which could be under root b by rho, but velocity directly given to us. this should be equal to 1100. So 2n minus 1 divided by 4 multiplied by 330 is equal to 1100. All right. If I solve this equation, n must belong to integer. If n doesn't come out to be integer, if n is not integer when I solve this, then it is not possible. Okay, so let us see that. 11 tens are, 11 threes are. So 2n minus 1 by 4 is equal to 10 by 3 minus 1 is 40 by 3. So 2n is 43 by 3. That does it. Have I made a silly error? I didn't took the length here. There should be length L in the denominator. Length L in the denominator. 2n this into length. Length is what? Length is 0.3. So 2n minus 1 becomes equal to 4. So 2n is equal to 5. N comes out to be 2.5, not integer. So not possible. Okay. Type in all of you, is this clear? This is from your textbook. All of you type in. Okay. It's a very simple question. Do it now. Actually, it is not on standing wave actually, but wave, you can say it is question from wave chapter, but not exactly on the standing wave. Anyone got the answer? A part. A is very simple. Vishal, how can... Ajay, that is a wavelength. I thought you're telling 0.03 meter is the depth of the sea. 0.03 meter is like 3 centimeter. Okay, Satyam got part A. Others, part A answer. What it is? Okay, so let's say this is the C. All right, so the speed of the wave is 1500. The signal is generated here. It goes into the sea, get reflected off, comes back. How much distance it has traveled? If length is L, it has traveled a distance of 2L. 2L distance is traveled, right? It at this much time, at this velocity. So velocity into time. So the length is 1500 into 0.4, that is 600 meters. That is length, or you can say the depth of the sea. B part, wavelength of this signal. How will you find out? Frequency is velocity divided by wavelength. So wavelength is velocity divided by frequency. Velocity is 1500 divided by 50 kilohertz. Point comes here, so 0.3. No. How many zeros? 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 0.03 meters. Okay, a straightforward question. This is the school level stuff. Okay, just pay a little bit more attention. All of you will be able to solve it. All right. Let us find out something else. Do this on standing wave. Yeah, 0.0. Did I write 0.05? What did I write, Vihan? Correct. Do this. No. And why are you focusing on calculation? Focus on the concept. Calculation, it's your. Shall we do it now? Anyone about to get the answer? Okay. It's a guitar string of length 0.9 meters. The fundamental frequency is 124 hertz. Where should it be pressed to produce a fundamental frequency of 186 hertz? Okay. So what will be the same between the two scenarios? What will be the something that will be same for the two scenarios? Let's say it is pressed over here. Effective length would be now this L1. Velocity of the wave will be same. Okay. So this frequency 124 is a fundamental frequency for this much length. So this is equal to 1 divided by 2L into V. Right? And 186 should be equal to 1 divided by 2L1 into V. These are two equations. You can divide it. V will be gone. 124 divided by 186. Anybody did like this and get the answer? What do you get for this multiplication? This is equal to 0.6 meters, is it? Let me quickly check it. 124 divided by 186. Yeah, it is 0.6. Okay, you guys are also checking with the calculator. Don't use calculators, okay? I mean, you will not get it in the exam. So you should have a habit of doing hand calculations. Do this. Okay. One answer is there. Let us do this. Let us do this. Okay. It's a sonometer wire. Length is 1 meter. Where should the two bridges be kept? Let's say this is one bridge, other bridge. Okay. Is L1, this is L2, this is L3. So that their fundamental frequencies are of the ratio 1:2:3. So there will be a standing wave here, standing wave there, and standing wave there also. Fundamental frequencies. Okay. Fundamental frequency for length L1 is 1/2 L1 into velocity of the sound or velocity of the wave. F2 is 1/2 L2 velocity of the wave. F3 is 1/2 L3 velocity of the wave. We know that F1 is to F2 is to F3, which is 1/L1 is to 1/L2 is to 1/L3. This is 1:2:3. Okay. So 1/L1 is, let's say, K. Then 1/L2 is 2K. 1/L3 is 3K because the ratio is such. So L1 is 1/K. L2 is 1/2K. L3 is 1/3K. And L1 plus L2 plus L3 should be equal to 1 meters. So basically 1/K plus 1/2K plus 1/3K is equal to 1. What do you get the value of K? What is K? K comes out to be 6/11. 6/11. So L1 is 1/K, 11/6. L2 is 1/2K. So 11/12. Then 11/18. So like that, you get the answers. Clear to all of you? Type in. Actually, this thing is slightly tricky. The mathematics part is slightly twisted. Other than that, it is all fine. Ashita is saying K is 11/6. Is K 11/6 or 6/11? Satyam, what do you get? You want me to do the calculation also here? K is in a denominator, Harshita and Vishal. K is in the denominator. You haven't noticed it. Okay. This is 6K. 6 plus 3 plus 2. Is 1. So what is K? 11/6. Oh. What, Satyam? All right. Yeah, of course. The when you add up, it can't be greater than 1. So 11/6 is K. 6/11 is L1. Okay, so like that you can get the value of, now use these equations, this one and this one, to solve it. All right, let's take one last question for today. And here is the lucky question for you. Do it. what could be the fundamental frequency? What do you think? And what kind of tube it is? One end closed or both ends open? Can you see that 600 is 2 times 300? So can it happen for one end closed? Even multiple times one frequency is the other one? Can it happen? No, one frequency can never be even multiple of the other frequency like this. Okay. All right. So we need to first find out the fundamental frequency. So if one of them is fundamental frequency, it can be 300 only. Fundamental is the least frequency. All right. So 600 is 2 times 300. Well and good. But 750 is not integer times 300. So it cannot be 300. It is less than 300. Okay. It cannot be 100. Okay. Can it be 50? The answer is yes. But if it is 50, then 50 into 6 is 300. So there are not 6 possible frequencies. There are many possible frequencies then. So it cannot be 50. So is 150? Looks like, because 150 into 1 is 150. That is fundamental. 150 into 2, second harmonic, 300. 150 into 3, 450. 150 into 4, 600. Into 5, 750. And 150 into 6 is 900. These are the 6 harmonics. 150 is the fundamental one. And this is missing. And which one? 750, 900 is there. 150. 150 and 450 are missing. All right. So this is how you solve this particular question. Fine. So we will again meet next week and continue this chapter. Next week will be the last session on the waves. Okay. And then we'll sit down and understand what we should do in a couple of more classes to come after the next week. Fine. So bye for now.